Hello, this is Farida, and I'd like to present to you my final project for the C programming class. I created a program that will find a zero input response for a second order linear time invariant system. So what is a zero input response? Basically, it's the response due to internal system conditions, with the initial conditions being set to zero. When we speak of initial conditions, we mean things like energy stored in electrical components such as capacitors and inductors and so on. So let's say that you have a voltage equation and then you perform the Laplace transform to it. And then you solve this equation, perform the inverse Laplace transform. You split this equation into two, the zero input response and the zero state response. And the sum of these two components will give you the total response of the system. We're going to focus on finding the zero input response in this program. So you solve for the zero input response. And how do we do that? We set the input to zero. You let y of t be zero. And then you factor the equation. That means you form the auxiliary equation or the characteristic equation, in other words. And then solve for the lambda values. The lambda values will indicate the type of roots that we got, which will then determine the zero input response. The zero input response can be represented depending on the initial conditions and the types of roots. The types of roots that we got are non-repeating roots, which is this complementary solution, repeating real roots, which is this complementary solution, and complex conjugate roots, which is this complementary solution. So, how did I script version 1? Well, here's how we did it. I first take two coefficients from the user and utilize it in a for loop, and then extract them from the array. Next, I take the initial conditions, y and y prime. And then I utilize two user-defined functions named roots and general solution for computing the roots and general solution. And the roots and general solution will be utilizing a header file called the roots header file. And that roots header file has a couple of macros that will compute the, depending on the type of roots you got, it'll compute the C values for you. So the roots will indicate a different response for each system. So let's say that we have complex conjugate roots. That means that we're going to have alpha and beta, and alpha is the real part of the root, and beta is the imaginary part of the root. And then we compute theta, if applicable, if it's a complex conjugate root. And then we compute the constants. And then afterwards, we construct the response from these computations. So how did I derive these equations so I can place them in my script? We're going to start with the non-repeating roots. So I look at the complementary solution. And then I let the initial condition, I apply the initial condition, and then I solve for a C value. In this case, it's C1. So then this is going to be my first equation. Afterwards, I'm going to differentiate y of t, and then I'm going to apply the second initial condition. And then in the sequence of steps, I'm manipulating the equation to solve for C2. And then on to the next page, we find that C2 is equal to this equation. So this equation for C2, I'm going to substitute C2 in the first equation right here. Place C2 in this variable C2 here. And then we're finally getting C1. So that will compute C1 for us. So we put C2 and C1 equations in the non-repeating real roots UDF, user-defined function. So this is the non-repeating real roots part. For the derivation of the equation for the repeating real roots, we're going to go ahead and do the same thing, form the auxiliary equation, and then after the sequence of steps by manipulating the equation, we find that y0 is equal to c1. So that means we can just go ahead and use y0 for finding c1. We don't really need to go any farther. It makes it quite simple. The next step, I'm differentiating y of t and applying the second initial condition. And then after some simplification, we find that c2 is equal to this equation here. So we're just going to put c2 and y0 to compute the results for us. And that's going to get us c1 and c2. Now for the complex conjugate roots. Of course, we use the quadratic equation for the determinant. This is a very important part of the script. We need to know the type of determinant so we can know if it's going to end up in complex conjugate roots or not. So here I use the quadratic equation and I'm looking at this part here, and this part is a determinant. We find that the determinant is negative. What does that mean? That means they are complex conjugate roots. So I take the negative out of the root, of the square root, and then we get this j, the imaginary number, out. And then we get lambda 1 as minus 2 plus j6, and lambda 2 as minus 2 minus j6, where alpha is negative 2 and beta is 6. So the alpha is the real part and beta is the imaginary part. Now we're going to go ahead and solve for C. So in a sequence of steps, well, the first thing we need to do is we need to form the equation for C. So we formed the equation for C right here after a sequence of steps. Here it is. C is equal to y0 divided by cosine of theta. So now we're going to go ahead and solve for theta so that we can replace theta in this equation to solve for C. And then we find that theta is going to be the arctangent of this whole expression right here. Now we're going to use this theta and substitute it into C. So we put C, y0 divided by cosine of theta, and by that time we already have found what theta is. And then we place that in our script. How did I script version 2? Well, it's pretty much the same thing as the first one, with the exception that we are going to read from a file called data.txt and then write the results to a new file called result.txt. And another thing that's different about version 2 is that we remove the scanf function, because we don't really need to prompt the user. This program will automatically compute everything for you, so we don't need to ask the user what coefficients we have and what initial conditions we have, since data.txt already has that for us. So what was the most challenging part? Well, I'd say that learning about pointers was one of the parts that I was still in process of learning. It wasn't really that bad, though. I just needed to enhance my
learning on it. It took me a little while to grasp on, but then I realized that it really makes scripting a breeze, because there were times where I wanted to pass some values from a user-defined function into another user-defined function. So that's when I found pointers to be really handy. What I did is that I passed that value, I returned that value to main function, and then I grabbed those values from main into another UDF using pointers. And that was tremendously helpful. What was my opinion? Well, I'd have to say that, wow, I mean, it was quite nostalgic. It was a reminisce. I was traveling down memory lane as I was scripting this each late night. And I found it really fascinating that I was evoking my previous knowledge from my differential equations class and then forming a program that would compute a differential equation for you. I found that really cool. And, you know, that things like that, it makes you think, what have I learned? Never subtract from what you know, because we utilize our previous skills as we proceed in life from time to time, and you never know when these skills will manifest when you need them. Any dormant knowledge that we have is very handy to harbor. First and foremost, Dr. Zhang, I wanted to say thank you. Thank you very much for teaching me this class. It was tremendously helpful. It really was tremendously helpful, because without your help, I wouldn't have been excelling in my other class, embedded systems. And I'm going to talk about that in a little bit. So, this means gamasabdina, means thank you in Korean. I hope that I said it right. And the second line means arigato, thank you in Japanese. So, I need to give you credit for excelling in embedded systems class. So, we had an incident in class where the zeros weren't displaying in our LCD screen. We had a source file, a C source file for liquid crystal display. And there were a few errors in that C source file. It took me a while to figure it out though, because I thought that it was something with my code. I thought that it was something with my matrix keypad, that it's not assigning zeros correctly or so. But I looked into that source C file for the liquid crystal display, and one of the user-defined functions, there was something really weird about it. The thing is that there was a while loop. There were two while loops. The problem was within the second while loop. The second while loop, after several modulus operations and divisions by 10, you take, okay, so the while reverse number greater than zero. That's the problem. It says while reverse number is greater than zero. And then in the final part of this while loop, when you do the division operation, division by 10, and then you get, for the very last digit, you get 0.1. Zero, you take zero for int, now it thinks that there are no digits left. So that's why it's been ignoring the zero. That's why it's not displaying the zero in the LCD screen. So here's what I did to fix that script. I'm going to go ahead and pull up that script. Liquid crystal I2C. So this is my modification here. What I did is I initialized the digits counter, an unsigned int data type is zero. And then I replaced the first while loop with an
with an if. And I said, if number is equal to zero, then print zero on the LCD screen. That means if somebody types zero, then it'll display zero on the LCD screen right away. Else, if while number is greater than zero, reverse num this whole modulus operation here, that was the same from the last script. But the difference here is that I put digits plus plus. I incremented digits. That means every time that every iteration of the while loop, it's going to count how many digits the user input from the keypad. And then I put a for loop for I zero, I smaller than digits, increment I. This is the same syntax from the last one, this whole thing. And that's it. Now it knows how many digits are there, and this fixes the zeros issue. And it, now it will display the correct zeros on the LCD successfully, because now it knows how many digits are there. So I just wanted to say, if I hadn't been taking your class right now simultaneously with embedded systems, I wouldn't have known this. I would probably be lost. So I wanted to say, I wanted to tell you, thank you. Thank you very much. Arigato, Dr. Zhang. Thank you for your teachings. I really appreciate your time. Hand me the Michael Jackson hat, will you? Billie Jean is not my lover. Domo arigato, Mr.